today. Thank you so much for coming out and being a part of our services. Just before we start with our song service this morning, we're going to ask Judy to come, and she's going to give us a little rundown of some of our missionaries and what's going on with some of those folks today. So thank you very much for being here.
He is getting a reputation. Good morning. We were going to have a missionary here this morning, Chuck Ward, but he is having some health issues and is unable to come. So you're stuck with me. I was going to talk to you about the Lins. They are in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. And you probably already know that that's a pretty heavily populated Muslim country. They said that they're used to hearing the calls to prayer in a distance. But the other day they woke up and they had started building a mosque right outside their bedroom window. And it took them 3 days and the mosque was up. And now they listen to the call to worship right next door 5 times a day. So you might pray about that. She said there are over 40 million Muslims in the country and that they're using the call to prayer as a reminder to continue to pray for Christian influence and for the people to accept the Lord, the real God. There are building plans that I think the last time I talked to you about them, they were really, really excited about starting a building. And those have been put on hold because the office that approves the plans is temporarily closed. They said that within the government happens a lot, whether it's to root out corruption or whatever, they close them. So that's on hold. You can pray about that for God's timing. And one of the things that they said is just to, the importance of looking for opportunities to tell people about Jesus. Soccer is a really big thing, and I guess it's what they do, what the kids do on Sunday mornings before church. And the goalie was injured and is out for quite a while. And so Jeremy used that as an opportunity to really invest in this kid's life, in the waiting rooms of the hospitals, at home, take him out to lunch. And as a result, he's going to be baptized very soon. So I guess the question I ask myself then is, and I ask you, are we taking opportunities to witness to people? I hope we are, and I hope we grow in that.
Thank you very much, Judy. Appreciate that. If I could ask the guys to come up, we're going to sing a few songs for you this morning. We're going to introduce you here in just a few minutes to a brand new song. Well, brand new to us song, okay? But we'll be talking about more about that in just a minute. Stand with me. Let's sing a few verses of At the Cross, At the Cross.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my done. He groaned upon the tree. Amen.
shake somebody's head this morning, make sure they're welcomed here.
Don't do sanctuary. Let's go straight into here. Yeah. That means not now or not at all.
Henry, skip it. Skip. Yeah. Thank you, may be seated. These devices we have in our hands nowadays. This is a song that is about 5 years old. You know, it's so for us, it's pretty contemporary. But I don't remember who the very first time I heard it. It was just one of those songs that just spoke so deeply to me. And it's a very easy, singable song. And I want you to listen to it. But the very first line of the song is, "What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer?" And then it just goes on and talks about all of the things of Jesus, what he's done for us and what he's done in our lives. "There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold. My hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine. I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but Christ through me." And so the words are the most important line. This line that just keeps coming back to my life, to my heart every time is, "Yet not I, but Christ through me." It's not about me. It's not about what I've done or what I can do or could do. It's about what Jesus did on that cross. It's about what God our Father did by sending his son Jesus. It's all about them. It's all about us worshiping them and honoring them. And this is one of the most beautiful songs I think you'll hear. And so you can pick up the words as you go, but at least read the words. And if the tune becomes easy for you to sing, there's four straight verses right straight through. So you'll feel the repeat. You'll hear the repeat, but just sing along with us as you can. But give us just worship with us through this song this morning, would you? What gift of grace?
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and deep.
Number two.
The night. dread. I know I am forgiven. The future's sure. The price has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon. And he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I
guys think. Beautiful song. Beautiful song. Another beautiful song that we've done a few times before, and Nathan gets the opportunity to start us off, although he doesn't like that, but we give him that opportunity every once in a while.
Thank you.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this day, for the opportunity you've given us to worship you, for the opportunity we can come together and just praise your name for who you are and what you have done in our lives. Father, we ask that you be with Steve as he brings this message to us today. Continue to bless him. Continue to give him the words and the thoughts that you have given him already throughout the week, that we may just be able to break open the word of God and the bread of life and just give it to us in such a fashion we can take it home and use it in our lives. In Christ's name we pray these things. Amen.
Good morning. We are going to start off in John chapter 6 today, starting with the 26th verse. Now, just set the context here. There was the feeding of the 5,000 has already taken place. Then Jesus walked on water, went out to disciples on the water, and then now it is the next day. And Jesus is talking to some of the people who were there at the feeding of the 5,000. Jesus answered them and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me, not because you saw signs, because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you, for on him the Father God has set his seal." Now, Jesus here is talking about spiritual food. He's not talking about physical food. Well, he's talking about physical food too, but he's saying there's something more important than physical food, and that is spiritual food. And Jesus oftentimes did this in his ministry. He would take physical things and apply it in a spiritual nature. He did this many times. So then, therefore, they said to him, "What shall we do so that we may work the works of God?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So first and foremost, you have to believe in Jesus. And guys, that is first and foremost in every person's life. If you have never given your life to Jesus Christ and trusted him for your salvation, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is utmost. It is the greatest decision a person can ever make, and it is foremost, most important with every individual person to make that decision to follow Jesus Christ and be a believer in Jesus. And so Jesus is saying, look, first, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. Well, who is that? That is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's standing right there before them. Now let's look and see how they respond. So they said to him, "What then do you do for a sign?" I just want to say unbelievable here, and that's a perfect application, really, because they just don't believe. Look, weren't they there? He said they were there at the feeding of the 5,000. What more signs do you need? I mean, think of that. There's 5,000 men, and then some of them had families with them, so now tell them how many people were there, and they passed the loaves. Where did all this food come from? And then there's food left over. What do you need? What more do you need for a sign? The problem is some people just refuse to believe, and that's the truth. No matter if they saw a sign, they saw a miracle. Jesus said, even if somebody, he was telling unbelievers, even if somebody was raised from the dead, you would not believe. And he was talking about his own resurrection, I can't remember the context there. Maybe Lazarus was already raised from the dead, or Lazarus was about to be raised from the dead. See, believing is not really, it's not really necessary that there are facts or evidence or signs. Believing is a choice to believe, and that is the most important part about it, most important element. You choose to believe. In this day in which we live now, it's hard to believe in what you see on TV, and if you watch the news, you're choosing to believe it because there's very little evidence for any of it anymore. It's hard to believe it. I mean, you have to put more faith in the news channel than you do to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's much more evidence for what he did in the resurrection than what these people on the TV are saying anymore. Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God. You believe." So they said, "What then do you do for a sign so that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform?" Now here I think Jesus probably gave them the look, because he didn't answer the question. And you know what the look is, right? If you're a parent, you worked on your look and you perfected it through the years of having children. Or maybe you remember back to your childhood and you remember having the look. Well, I think Jesus gave them the look here. Our fathers, and then they don't get a sign, they don't get an answer, they don't even get a word. I think it's just a look. And then verse 31, "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat." Now this conversation, I think Jesus has been leading it down this road from the very beginning. Remember the loaves and the fishes and the 5,000 and all this. They're asking for a sign, and this is on their mind. And Jesus was leading the conversation. And you can go back and see this when he met with Nicodemus in the middle of the night. He led the conversation in the direction he wanted it to go. And then with the woman at the Samaritan well, he led the conversation in the direction he wanted to go. He used water then. He used being born again with Nicodemus. So he's doing the same thing here with these people. Now, our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and as written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat. Well, where do you think all that bread came from? No, it wasn't manna at the feeding of the 5,000, but it was a miraculous event to multiply the loaves and fishes and to show God's power, Jesus' power over provision also. Now, Jesus says something very interesting here. Jesus then said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread out of heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread out of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world." So now what bread is Jesus talking about? He's done the same thing. He's taking their line of thinking and he's reapplying it to himself. Now this bread that he's talking about now, this true bread, is Jesus Christ in person. So now this is amazing because he's taking himself and he's saying, go back to the Old Testament, to this sign that you asked for. Okay, this sign that you're talking about as far as the manna coming down in the wilderness. Right? And Jesus is saying, there's a much greater sign standing in person right before you right now because I am the true bread that comes down out of heaven. In other words, the manna in the wilderness was symbolic and it was a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ coming in person. Now, I think that's amazing. I think that's fascinating. Then they said to him, "Lord, always give us this bread." Jesus said to them, he's making it very clear, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." So he's talking about spiritual hunger and spiritual thirst there. I mean, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, and sometimes I get hungry. I probably shouldn't. I eat too much, right? But at the same time, I can't say I've never been thirsty or never hungry. It's not talking about that. He's talking about spiritual hunger and spiritual thirst. Now, there will come a time when I will never be hungry and thirsty again for anything. I will be completely satisfied and fulfilled in heaven when everything is perfected. But at the same time, Jesus here is saying, "I am the bread of life." So again, he's applying the manna in the wilderness to him. He is the true bread that came down from heaven. So now I want to go back and look at this in Exodus chapter 16. We'll start at verse 4 and 5 when the miracle of the manna is about to take place. "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them, whether or not they will walk in my instructions. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily.'" So now how is the testing going to take place? Here's this manna going to rain down from heaven, okay, and they have to go out and gather a certain amount, okay? And if they gather and they try to keep it overnight, what's going to happen to the manna? It's going to spoil. It'll get worms in it. And then here's further testing for the Sabbath. You see, it won't last overnight, right? But on the preparation for the Sabbath, they're to gather extra, and then it won't spoil, and they'll have it for the Sabbath. You see that? So they have to do that on faith. So this is a matter of testing. Now, I think it's interesting. Also, it always comes down to faith. Doesn't it always come down to faith? And look at Jesus Christ now. He is the true bread that came down from heaven. Isn't he the dividing line? Isn't he the one that everything will be tested by? If you go to the great judgment, the great white throne judgment in the book of Revelation, so there's two books that everybody will be judged by that's an unbeliever. The first book is like a book of actions. Basically, they take the book and does this person have sin on their account? Well, then the second book is the Lamb's Book of Life. And if their name was not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, then they're cast into the lake of fire. So the only way anybody ever makes it is by having your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. You see, it's a testing of faith. You have to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Just like Jesus said, He is the dividing line. He is the measure, right? And he is either for you in this room, if you're an unbeliever, he is a rock of stumbling and offense, or for you, he is your foundation stone. He is on which everything in your life is built upon. So yes, there is a testing. And guys, in this life, even as believers, our faith will be tested. So on the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily. Then in verse 6, so Moses and Aaron said to all the sons of Israel, at evening you will know that the Lord has brought you out of the land of Egypt. Well, how would they know that so far? Weren't they there when they saw the 10 plagues? Weren't they there when the Red Sea parted? The pillar of fire was keeping the Egyptian army away from them? Haven't they seen all this? You know, guys, we don't need to be like them. We have the Holy Spirit. Don't wallow around in doubts and unbelief. Don't be like the stiff-necked people, right, that just refuse to believe and over and over and saw it over and over. So Moses and Aaron said to all the sons, at evening you will know that the Lord has brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you will see the glory of God. Now I think this is amazing. The glory of God. Now think of what they've already seen. They've seen the parting of the Red Sea, the 10 plagues, all of this stuff they've seen. The Passover, where the 10th plague passed over and they didn't lose all their firstborn by the blood of the Lamb on their doorposts, right? They've seen all this, right? But yet in the morning, what are they going to see? The glory of the Lord. Doesn't that sound like maybe an overstatement? This is just going to be some bread that rains down out of heaven. That seems like a small thing compared to everything they've seen so far. Well, it's not. Because what they're going to see is the bread that comes down out of heaven, which is symbolic of the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And here in the scriptures it says, the glory of the Lord. I don't think that's an accident at all. Seems out of place if you don't understand what it really means. You mean this bread that we're gathering up off of weeds and trees and the ground and all this stuff is the glory of the Lord? Yes, it is, because it is bread that came down from heaven, symbolically of the true bread that comes down out of heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ. When God walked the face of the earth, the Son of God came, the only begotten. You will know that the Lord has brought you out of the land of Egypt. In the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, for he hears your grumblings against the Lord. And what are we that you grumble against us? So in other words, Moses and Aaron are saying, why are you grumbling against us? You know, God is the one. You grumble against us, you're grumbling against God, is what he's saying. Look at verse 8. Moses said, this will happen when the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and bread to the full in the morning. Now look at this. He had some quail brought in by a wind, and this didn't continue, but it happened more than once throughout their 40 years in the desert. But here you have, look at what it says. Be careful to notice what it says. When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and bread to the full in the morning, for the Lord has heard your grumblings, which you grumble against him. And what are we? Your grumblings are not against us, but against the Lord. So he's going to give them meat, but yet in the scriptures, if you look at that word, he's going to give them manna to the full. It's going to be fulfilling. And I think this is beautiful, a beautiful picture of the symbolism of Jesus Christ, because he is the only thing that truly fulfills and fills. He is the only thing. The quail aren't going to do that. The meat and the quail aren't going to fulfill them. But this bread, they're going to have to the full. It's not like they could take a whole bunch of extra and eat till they sit back and rub their tummies. That's not what it's talking about. This bread that comes down out of heaven is the true bread. It is true food and is the only thing that really fulfills. If you're an unbeliever in this room and you've been searching for fulfillment, the only place you will ever find true fulfillment is in the Lord Jesus Christ. And here is this manna, as opposed to other meals. It is true food indeed, and it is fulfilling. It is satisfying, and it is really all you need. Now, what did they eat? They had meat from time to time. They got, I guess, tired of eating the same thing, and they grumbled again, and God sent them some more quail. But for the most part, what did they eat every single day in the wilderness for 40 years? Manna. Well, maybe they were running short on some vitamins. You know, think about that. This manna was like the perfect food. It was true food. Not only was it fulfilling and it was pleasing, but it was everything that they needed for life. They didn't have to take their Centrum Silver. It already had everything they needed in it. Now, where was I? Okay, we're down to verse 13. I didn't even go that far. Let's read on. Then Moses said to Aaron, say to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, come near, this is verse 9, before the Lord, for he has heard your grumblings. And it came about as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the sons of Israel that they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. And the Lord spoke to Moses. Isn't that interesting there? The glory of the Lord. Isn't that the same word that was just applied to the manna? You're going to see the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud, and the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, I have heard the grumblings of the sons of Israel. Speak to them, saying, at twilight, look at this, you shall eat meat. Okay, at twilight, you shall eat meat. Look at this. And in the morning, you shall be filled with bread. You see it? Don't you think they were hungry? Don't you think they got full of quail? But it didn't satisfy them. It wasn't fulfilling like the bread that came down from heaven. You shall be filled with bread, and you shall know that I am the Lord your God. Now in verse 13, so it came about at evening that the quails came up and covered the camp. See, there was plenty to fill them up. That's not the fulfilling it's talking about, right? And covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew evaporated, behold, on the surface of the wilderness, there was a fine flake-like thing, fine as the frost on the ground. When the sons of Israel saw it, they said to one another, what is it? For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, it is the bread which the Lord has given you to eat. So now this bread that came down from heaven is something new. They had never experienced this before. It was something new. They didn't expect it. They had never experienced it. Well, turn now to the book of Isaiah. We're going all over the place today. Isaiah chapter 42. One of my favorite chapters in Isaiah 42. And what we're going to look at the first four verses, God the Father is talking about God the Son. I don't know if you've ever seen this chapter before, but it's pretty amazing. Behold my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry out or raise his voice, nor make his voice heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not extinguish. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not be disheartened or crushed until he has established justice on the earth, and the coastlands will wait expectantly for his law. You know, we're the coastlands, right? We shall wait expectantly for his law, his word. Look at verse 5. You think I'm making that up about who said this about the Son? Look at this. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and its offspring, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk on it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I will also hold you by the hand and watch over you. And I will appoint you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the nations, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the dungeon, and those who dwell in darkness from prison. I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not give my glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. Now, wait a minute here. Who is he talking about then? Because it sounds like he's given his glory to somebody. But he's given his glory to the Son and the Holy Spirit. Well, see, he's not giving his glory to another, because God has three parts, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So he's talking about the Son, and he's praising the Son, and he's saying what the Son is going to do. Look at this. I am the Lord. That is my name. I will not give my glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. Look at this. Behold, the former things have come to pass. Now I declare new things. Before they spring forth, I proclaim them to you. So now he's declaring new things. And see, this new thing that's going to happen is the true bread that comes down out of heaven, symbolically of the manna that came down. which was fulfilling, miraculous, and symbolic of the first coming of Jesus Christ. It's beautiful how all of it fits together. So he's declaring a new thing, and this manna that came down was a new thing. They didn't know what it was. They were confused. You know what? I don't know what this is. I declare to you before it even takes place. Just like the manna in the wilderness was a symbolic picture of the Lord Jesus coming at the first coming. And then in Isaiah 42, 700 years before Christ, God the Father talking to God the Son, I declare to you new things. I'm going to do something new that you do not expect. And the nation of Israel, many of them, were blind to the fact of what was really going on. It was a new thing that they did not expect. Now, continuing in verse 16, this is what the Lord has commanded. Gather of it every man as much as he should eat. You shall take an omer apiece according to the number of persons each of you has in his tent. The sons of Israel did so, and some gathered much, and some gathered little. When they measured it with an omer, he who had gathered much had no excess, and he who had gathered little had no lack. Every man gathered as much as he should eat. So some people went out there, and they gathered, and they didn't get enough. But then when it was measured, it was the right amount. Then some people went out there, and they gathered way too much. But then when they got back, it was the right amount. Isn't that amazing? Well, see, that's the beautiful thing about this true bread who comes down from heaven. Is if you got Jesus, you got him. You don't have too much. You don't have too little. You have him. You have all of him. Amazing, isn't it? See, just having Jesus, believing in Jesus, is all we really need. And it's fulfilling, and he is the true bread that comes down out of heaven. Moses said to them, let no man leave any of it until morning. But they did not listen to Moses, and some left part of it until morning. Well, maybe they were thinking, you know, I don't want it to go to waste. You know, my dad will be watching this in a little bit. My dad was under the mindset, he grew up when you didn't waste anything, and so if we didn't finish our plate, he'd finish our plates. I don't know if any of you have experienced that either from that generation, but then one day he realizes he's about 50 pounds overweight, maybe a little more. Dad can tell me later when I talk to him. And then he thought, well, wait a minute, it's still being wasted if I don't need it, and I'm putting it in my body, and now I'm getting fat. So he stopped doing that, but it wasn't easy for him because you always had to clean your plate, and if we didn't, he would clean it for us. Didn't want it to go to waste. So maybe these people said, you know what? We're going to save some till morning. Maybe we get up, we'd like some of this with our morning coffee. Or maybe they just said, you know, we're going to save some tomorrow because we lack faith to believe that it's going to be there tomorrow. I don't really know why, but they didn't do what they were supposed to do when they had, no, that's verse 19. Let no one leave any of it till morning. But they did not listen to Moses, and some left part of it until morning, and it bred worms and became foul. And Moses was angry with them. You know, this manna, this perfect, perfect, fulfilling food, when it's associated with disobedience, it becomes this foul worm, this foul thing. Kind of striking, isn't it, that something so perfect from God could become so foul and nasty. Well, guys, what happened to Jesus Christ on the cross? He was the perfect true food, perfection, no sin. Well, on the cross, our sins, our ugliness, our nastiness was placed on the true bread. Now think of that. And the beautiful true bread, the perfect true bread from heaven, became the nasty. Doesn't seem to fit, does it? Well, that's how much he loved us. He became that for us so that we could be white as the driven snow, as pure as the true bread from heaven. Amazing to think about. So this perfect manna would become foul if it was associated with disobedience or sin. Moses said to them, let no man leave any of it till morning. But they did not listen, and they left part of it until morning, and it bred worms and became foul. And Moses was angry with them. They gathered it morning by morning, every man as much as he should eat, but when the sun grew hot, it would melt. Now on the sixth day, they gathered twice as much bread, two omers each for one. Now remember, it turns foul overnight, right? So they're going to have to gather for the Sabbath on faith. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much bread, two omers for each one. When all the leaders of the congregation came and told Moses, then he said to them, this is what the Lord meant. Tomorrow is a Sabbath observant, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. Bake what you will bake and boil what you will boil, and all that is left over put aside to be kept until morning. So they put it aside until morning as Moses had ordered, and it did not become foul, nor was there any worm in it. Moses said, eat it today, for today is a Sabbath to the Lord. Today you will not find it in the field. 6 days you shall gather it, but on the seventh, the Sabbath, there will be none. And it came about on the seventh day that some people went out to gather, but they found none. Then the Lord said to Moses, how long do you refuse to keep my commandments and my instructions? See, the Lord has given you the Sabbath, therefore he gives you bread for 2 days on the sixth day. Remain every man in his place. Let no man go out of his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day. See, it was a matter of faith. You know, without faith, it is impossible to please God. And here, some of these people were failing the test of faith. The house of Israel named it manna. And it was like, get this description. It was like coriander seed, white, and its taste was like wafers with honey. Now the coriander seed, I thought, well, that's interesting because that is an ancient spice, goes long before even the Exodus, this spice was being used in places. And I think it was interesting when I was studying this, I ran across this, probably not a coincidence, but also perhaps it is. But supposedly the ancients believed that the best coriander, which is really the seeds that grows on a cilantro plant. You're probably more familiar with cilantro, but coriander seed is a seed that grows on cilantro. And the ancient people believed that the best coriander spice came out of Egypt. I think that's interesting. You know, maybe God did it because they came out of Egypt and they were used to that spice. Or maybe God did it also because he called his son out of Egypt. Remember the scripture and the prophecy? He called his son out of Egypt. Pliny the Elder, a Roman official that lived during the time of Jesus Christ, said himself that the best coriander comes out of Egypt. And can't we say for sure the best spice, the best bread, the best of everything, the best of any true food came out of Egypt as a young man after he fled there from with his family from Herod. But also, so there's coriander seed, and then it is white. Well, in the Bible, white is always signified with purity. You know, when we return with the Lord Jesus Christ, we are going to have white robes, symbolizing that no longer we aren't associated with sin. We have the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Remember when he's on the cross and he took all of our nastiness and our ugliness, everything, even sins of omission, and he placed them on Jesus Christ. And then in the Psalms it says he separates our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. So we are as pure as the driven snow. We may not feel like it, but we are, and that is our destiny. And look at this. The manna, the true bread out of heaven, is white. It is pure. It is sinless. It is without tarnish or blemish. Be careful eating snow outside. Sometimes that can have a blemish you're not aware of, right? But this wasn't like that. Okay, now what else about it? Okay, it was like coriander seed. It was white, symbolizing purity and perfection. And its taste was like wafers with honey. So it was sweet. Man, if you've ever tasted that the Lord is good, it is sweet. God, it is the only food that fulfills. It is the only thing that will ever satisfy. This manna from heaven. I'm going to close with Psalm 34. Praising the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul will make its boast in the Lord. The humble will hear it and rejoice. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces will never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of God, which is the true bread out of heaven, encamped around those who fear him and rescues them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Have you tasted the true bread who comes down from heaven? Have you tasted and seen that the Lord is good? For he is. He is the true bread. He is the only one that fulfills. He is the manna that comes down from heaven. He is God Almighty. I hope he is your foundation stone and not a rock of offense or stumbling. If he is, Jesus said it himself, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. He will no longer be a rock of stumbling or offense for you. He will be your foundation stone and you will taste and see that the Lord is good, the true manna who comes down from heaven. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, thank you for the true manna who comes down from heaven. Thank you for his perfect life. But God, thinking of him on the cross, the perfect manna who came down from heaven, and God, then those worms and the foulness of all of our sins that were placed upon Jesus Christ so that we also could be pure and white as the manna that was formed on the ground in the morning. God, thank you so much for Jesus Christ. Thank you for his willingness and his determination to go to the cross, his determination to never look to sin and to live a perfect life so that he could be the perfect Lamb of God. God, thank you also for the symbolism. Thank you for the Old Testament, a foreshadowing of what you were going to do, something new, something unexpected coming as the suffering Lamb of God. God, thank you so much that we in this room, for those that believe, have tasted that the Lord is good. Help us to walk by faith. Help us to walk by faith and not by sight. If there is an unbeliever in this room, I pray that they would see the difference between the pure white manna and the foul sin and worms. God, I pray that they would make a decision to follow Jesus today during this time of invitation. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise for just a moment. I don't know where.